desire, Jesus, precious Lamb, who ransomed me. Upon the cross, he took my sin, by his blood he set me free. I desire Jesus, oh, his name my soul esteems. For upon his thorn-scarred brow is the crown of victory. He is worthy.
My soul must sing you.
precious Lamb who ransomed me. And unto you an offering will my life forever be.
Apologize there. Should wear my mask up and down. I'm there talking to every one of them, realizing I have my mask on. I apologize. Turn in your Bibles, if you would, to 1 Timothy chapter 6. Appreciate the ladies' song. We lift up the name of Jesus. That makes this a good service. His name is praised and honored. I was thinking of the words, this is my Father's world. And said, Jesus shall be satisfied. And I thought that's an interesting phrase. I wonder what that means. I'll have to think and meditate on that. But I hope you pay attention, and the words that you sing are a praise to our mighty God. I want you to understand, you being here today means something. It says something about you. I don't know if you know that or not. But it says that you're not 100% Baptist. I think the neighbors can hear me now. Okay, we're good. You're not 100% Baptist, because if you're Baptist, every little scare of a snowflake would keep you away from church. And so since you are here means you're not 100% Baptist, but some of you are holding it up by being in the back row in the back, so that's enough to be a Baptist right there. Speaking of being a Baptist, next week we start a new series. That series is going to be about the Apostles' Creed. Sometimes Baptists don't hold the creeds. I just think it's a good thing in our day and age as we go forward, and we have so many different battles that it seems like we're facing in our life, that we need to know exactly in what we believe. And so I think that the Apostles' Creed gives us a basis of what we believe, and so we're going to be starting that series next week. Let me also say just a word about the 14th. That's when we're going to be watching your children. We just realized this, that so many of us are under stress, under frustration. If your kids are able to go to school, not go to school, things are different. And we just think the kids need a day to hang out. And so we do have an activity scheduled. We will do those things, but it will not be like youth group where everyone's made to participate in the one activity. It'll be basically a day for your kids to hang out. I know a lot of you haven't signed up in the back, but you signed up in the office. So we're glad that a number of kids are coming. We could use maybe another couple or so if you want to stay and help us. You don't have to stay the whole time. You can stay for a few hours. But we're just going to let the kids hang out. And the parents, we hope you just do whatever in the world you want to do. You go home, take a nap. You can go out to dinner. You can do whatever you want to do, just to give you a little break and to enjoy your company as a couple together. But today we're going to finish up our Back to Basics month and our four core principles of 2021. We started a month ago with an introductory message that explained that our main goal for 2021, which is our goal all the time, was to make much about God and less about us. Which thinking with John the Baptist, who said, he must increase and I must decrease. You know, it's pretty much an amazing and sobering practice if you take the time to evaluate your own life. And if you take the time to evaluate your own life and you realize just how much you've allowed your life to become about yourself. You know, in reality, if we're honest, truly honest, we worship ourselves far more than we worship our Creator. It's our fleshly natural tendency to make life about us. So we're going to try, as a group of believers that meet together on Sunday morning in corporate worship, to make our goal to make much about Him and less about us. And out of that desire, then, we came up with these four core principles. We were kind of thrown for a loop, I think all of us in the world, in 2020, where our world just changed on a dime. And we always said that, right? Life can change in a moment. But it happened in 2020 to all of us. And so we wanted in 2021 to have four principles, four core principles that If anything else goes crazy, we're going to go back to these core principles, and we believe that they're going to help us. There's other principles that are in our lives too, but we wanted to come back to these four principles as a church to help guide us. They've been conveniently written for us on this massive banner that I ordered that is way bigger than I thought it was going to be. So the goal is to keep that up for all of 2021, but I'm not sure it's going to make it that long because it's just obnoxiously large. Some of you, I appreciate your comments that if we were to put it right here, it would improve the church, especially when I'm preaching. I don't think we're going to do that, but we'll find a place for it. If you have an idea, if it gives you something to do during the message now, figure out where to put that massive banner. And if you say the dumpster in the parking lot, you lose. But those are four principles that we've been preaching on this month. In week one, actually week two, we spoke on the first principle. We believe that God gives us four sufficient gifts so that we can make much of Him. The Bible, the Holy Spirit, prayer, and other believers. And I spoke in that one, and I thought, you know, the reason that sometimes the Bible gets boring to us, the reason sometimes we don't live in the Spirit is because oftentimes we're not using the gifts that God gives us to minister. We're not placing ourselves on the front line. We're not walking in obedience to Jesus. When you do those things, when you use your gifts to minister to other people, when you walk in obedience to Jesus, you realize, you know something, I need the Bible. I need the Holy Spirit. I need prayer. And I need other believers. And then the third week, Josh spoke about that the gospel is enough. We believe that the gospel is enough to save us from our sin and a new life of holiness. And it's interesting how God teaches us those lessons. I ordered a book. This is the beginning of the year. A lot of new books come out. There's a book called The Gospel in Color, and it's called The Gospel in Color for Kids. And it's by the Gospel Coalition. Two men of color wrote this book. And basically what they did is said, here's the problem of racism. Here's how we see that it came about. And here's the issue of racial reconciliation. And here's the gospel. And they used the gospel to show how, listen, God created us good, and then we sinned, and then Jesus came and solved the problem of sin, and racial reconciliation is a problem of that fall. And I got done with the book, and I thought, well, that was pretty basic. And then I remembered Josh's message, and I'm like, oh my, we're just talking about this. That we must believe that the gospel truly is the answer to the issues we face as a nation. And when we get together and we lift up the gospel and we preach the gospel and we know the gospel, it is the gospel for life. It is the gospel that gives life, and it is the answer to the issues in our life. So we want to do that more this year. Then John's job was to speak about the truth that we're to live and speak in ways that shine the light of Jesus. And he used John chapter 15, speaking of abiding in the vine and allowing the abiding to shine to the world. And I would challenge you to use this unique opportunity to speak and live the gospel in more courageous ways this year. My task is the fourth commitment on the bottom. We believe we have been given more than enough so that we can share with others. It's a simple message, but I hope you'll pay attention. I hope you'll listen. Look at 1 Timothy chapter 6. 1 and 2 Timothy are part of what are called the pastoral epistles, or really the pastoral letters. It's Paul writing to his spiritual son Timothy. He'd assigned Timothy to the church at Ephesus. Now, if you read through the book, you're going to realize Timothy was young, kind of shy. He was struggling in a church with real powerful people. There's a bunch of people whose personalities would lend them to want to overpower and not respect Timothy. And it dawned on me this week, why would Paul leave Timothy with those kind of people? He knew Timothy's personality. He knew the church at Ephesus. He helped plant that church. And I believe the idea was that we're to learn from each other. Isn't that right? That's what makes the church of God so beautiful. That we don't all have to have the same personalities. Even pastor and congregation. Is that we're supposed to be different so that we can kind of round each other out. So that we can see a different picture of Jesus. So we can learn from each other. Too often we want our pastors or we want our congregants to be little mini-me's. You know, just be like me, or you be like me. You should be driven like me and do like I do. And that doesn't really make for a rounded picture of God. So Paul left Timothy in Ephesus, and 2 Timothy become these great pictures of what, you know, the church should look like. In our passage that we're going to look at today, Paul encourages Timothy to give a charge, to instruct these older, more established people. But it's more than instruction. It's an exhortation. It's an instructional challenge. Do this. And like always, you'll see in the passage, if you really pay attention, it's always the pastor's job to hear the Spirit, to preach the Word, and it's the congregation's job to hear and heed what God is saying. It can be a very powerful dynamic. And so Paul tells Timothy, hey, I charge you to say these things. He's charging the people as you read this letter. I want you to listen to these things because this is a message from me which was inspired by God to be given to you so that growth can take place and God can be glorified. Now, before we get to that charge, we've got to kind of make a running start to it. We've got to kind of read the context. So let's start in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 2, in the second part of verse 2. Paul says, teach and urge these things. If anyone teaches a different doctrine and does not agree with the sound words of our Lord Jesus Christ and the teaching that accords with godliness, he's puffed up with conceit and understands nothing. He has an unhealthy craving for controversy and for quarrels about words, which produce every dissension, slander, evil suspicions, and constant friction among people who are depraved in mind and deprived of the truth, imagining that godliness is a means of gain. So here Paul's describing these false teachers who have these false motives. You kind of wish at times that Paul would speak his mind more, that he would be a little more forceful. I said, wow, he just kind of blasts these guys. And basically, we'll just look at the last line because that's going to be where our charge goes to. They believe that this godliness or this religious thing was a means as gain in their life. They could gain reputation. They could gain influence. And especially, they thought it was a way to make money. And what these guys do, and you can see the pattern even today, is that they're not going to preach the truth of the gospel. They're going to stir up problems. They're going to come up with weird little things. They're going to create controversies so that people that like that kind of stuff, because we're drawn to those things, we don't like to be the norm, we'd rather go to the weird little ideas, can follow them, and they can get those people's money. But now he encourages Timothy not to do that. Look at verse 6. But godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into the world, and we cannot take anything out of the world. But if we have food and clothing, with these we will be content. But those who desire to be rich fall into temptation, into a snare, into many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. It is through this craving that some have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many pangs. So he's talking to the congregation, but he's especially talking to Timothy. And basically he says this, Timothy, you need to remember, godliness and contentment bring great gain. He's not talking about the fact that if you're godly and you're content, you're going to get more money. But if you're godly and content, you'll have great gain in your life. You'll be successful in life. You will know what's important in life. And great joy comes from knowing what is important in life. Now, this isn't the passage we're going to zero in on, but we look at it just a little bit. It's important to notice how Paul defines what's enough. It's one of those things that you do in church, and we say, yep, that's enough. But I'm not exactly sure we really truly believe that. But he says what? If you have food and clothing, you have enough. So immediately we say, yeah, not really. Right? Immediately we add what? Shelter. Well, you got to have shelter. Well, and if you live in Jersey, you got to have a car. Right? And so we continue to add to that. So we really don't believe what Paul's saying is enough. But the truth of the matter is I watch alone. You ever watch alone? Now, they have 10 items they're allowed to bring. They put these people out in the middle of the wilderness. And the idea is the first thing they do is do what? They build a shelter. So apparently we could build a shelter from whatever's out there. So this morning, or this afternoon, after church, we're going to go out in the woods and grab a bunch of leaves, make a shelter, and see if we can stay warm enough in that shelter, just to prove this passage. Some of you are on board with that, and we'll go ahead and do that. But the truth of the matter is, Paul says to Timothy, you only need food and clothing. Food to cover your shame because of sinfulness. We didn't even need, clothing to cover your shame. Food clothes is my shame, but clothing to cover your shame, right? Because in the garden they sinned and they were naked and all of a sudden now they have to cover their shame. It's an interesting little thought and study as you go through this. And food we need in order to survive. In fact, in that show Alone, The biggest issue they have is they go out there with no food. And they have to find their food. And that's why most people tap out, is because they don't have enough food. So shelter is really important. But you know, one of the things I've learned on Alone is, you know what really drives those people nuts? Is that they're not around anybody. So I would almost add food, clothing, and as we talk other ways, we need each other. We need each other. We get weird when we're alone. All you have to do is miss church 2 or 3 weeks in a row, and you'll get weird, right? You'll get weird about Christians. We get strange. I have to fight it. I'm alone in my office a lot. My wife said the other day, you're getting weird. You've got to get by people and, you know, and be around people a lot more, and she's right. And that's one of the things I think we've learned over these last 10 or 12 months. We need people. We need to be around people, no matter how much they drive us nuts at times, right? And we drive them nuts, and sometimes they drive us nuts, but we love them, and we want to be around them. But back to Paul's point. His point here, and this is where we're going to get to our charge, being poor is not the point. Sometimes we think that being poor is a virtue in and of itself, and that's not what Paul's saying. As if somehow being poor is godly and being rich is evil. But he's saying being content and godly is the virtue. When we lose our contentment and pursue riches, we often lose our soul. If you lose your contentment, right? And sometimes it just hits you, even as a mature Christian, where you're doing okay financially and 3, 4, 5 bills hit right in a row and you're like, holy smokes. And all of a sudden your savings is gone or you're in trouble a little bit and you begin to learn, listen, I am not really content. And what God has given to me, I was content in my bank account. But then Paul points Timothy, as we continue to work up to our charge, he points him towards godliness. Look at verse 11. But as for you, O man of God, flee these things. Run from them. Pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, steadfastness, gentleness. Fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called and about which you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. We should land here. Now, he's going to give a charge here now. We should really land here, but we're not. We're going to land on the verses after it. It's as if Paul just can't help himself. When he begins to talk about these things, encourage people, he goes immediately to the gospel. And he's going to say, listen, you need to fight the good fight. Take hold of eternal life. And then he just can't help himself. If you're going to do that, you need the gospel. I charge you in the presence of God who gives life to all things and of Christ Jesus, who in the testimony before Pontius Pilate made the good confession to keep the commandment unstained and free from a reproach until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he will display at the proper time. He who is the blessed and only sovereign, the King of kings and the Lord of lords, who alone has immortality, who dwells in unstoppable light, whom no one has ever seen or can see, to him be honor and eternal dominion. Amen. You see this, he says, listen, I want to encourage you to be godly. As soon as he does that, it encourages him to speak of the gospel and to begin to tell of the gospel. When he thinks of the gospel, it leads right to what? It leads right to worship and understanding and knowing the great grace that God has given and the great things that God has done through Jesus. And he just lifts up the name of God. The gospel's enough to save us from our sins and a life of holiness. But now we get to our fourth commandment. Come back with me. Our fourth commandment and found in verse 17. As for the rich in this present age, charge them not to be haughty, nor to set their hopes on the uncertain riches, but on God who richly provides us with everything to enjoy. They are to do good, to be rich in good works, to be generous and ready to share, thus storing up treasure for themselves as a good foundation for the future, so that they may take hold of that which is truly life. Listen, we need to hear the earlier verses. Godliness with contentment. We need to know what that means. We need to live godly lives. We need to live contented lives. Think of all the times during the week we're complaining about the things that we don't have. Right? And he's saying we need that principle. But the truth of the matter is, we really live in verse 17. We're rich. This charge is for us. We have more than food and clothing, which is what Paul says to Timothy is all you need. You know, I mentioned this before, but It made such an impact on my life. There's one day, I can't even remember what the occasion was, but I had to go to the store and get some rice. And I had a couple bucks in my pocket. My wife at that time used to send me to the store, then only give me the money I needed for that item. I don't know what she thought was going to happen. But the idea is, so I just had a few dollars to go buy this rice. And I can remember going to the store, and I don't go to the grocery store often, but I got to the grocery store aisle, and I was at the end of the aisle, and I just looked down the aisle. And I'm like, I got to get some rice. How hard is that? And I start looking down the aisle. Do you know how many different kinds of rice there is? And it was on the way over there that I was thinking to myself, because something had happened at church, or I'd seen a thing on TV in Ethiopia where these kids were just dying for a bowl of rice. And they would get a half a bowl for lunch and maybe a bowl for dinner, or they would only get the one meal. And I'm looking down this aisle and I'm thinking, I don't even know what kind of rice to buy. There was white rice, there was brown rice, there was rice-a-roni, there's long grain rice, there's instant rice, there's bowl in a bag rice. And there's huge bags of rice that you could buy. There's boxes of rice. And I was overwhelmed as I stood there thinking, how rich we are. I'm like, these kids don't have a bowl of rice, and I can't figure out which rice to buy with my couple of bucks. And I began to study this out, and you realize that in Jesus' day, that if you had multiple garments, you were rich. I guess I never really thought about that. Because Jesus especially was a wanderer, right? He was a nomad. And I don't think he had like the little sack carrying a bunch of stuff. He didn't have a suitcase full of clothes. He had the clothes on his back. If you had more than one or two, or more than two or three garments, you were considered rich. And really, I go into my I got a couple dressers full of stuff. I got one drawer full of socks, right? And you got all these different things, and I've got clothes in my one drawer that I'm hoping to grow back in or grow down into again. And I've got winter clothes, I got summer clothes. We have a walk-in closet. Do you guys have a walk-in closet? Is that not nuts? We're so very rich. And then if you think about one other thing, I was thinking about, we collect stuff. Is that not weird? Do you collect things? Are there things that you just like? It used to be Hummel things. Does anybody still collect Hummel things? I don't know if you guys know that. My mom used to collect what was called Toby mugs, or just little mugs that have a picture on them. And she hasn't bought one in a long time, but she's got this collection of Toby mugs. And we're all arguing amongst the kids of who has to take the Toby mugs and all that kind of stuff. But we collect silly stuff. One of the things that's really weird is we collect coins. Some of you collect coins. We have so much money that we collect coins and just put them aside, or we collect stamps. We're so rich, we just collect stuff, put it on a shelf, and admire that stuff. So when I look at this, as for the rich in this present age, I'm like, that's us. That's us. We need to hear the passage earlier, but this is really written for us. We're those people in Ephesus that were giving Timothy a hard time. That this young guy has to come and say, I know that in society you're way better off than I am. I know that in your jobs you're very powerful. I know that you have way more influence than I do. But Paul tells me, listen, I'm to charge you in these things. So I want to encourage you in these things. And the first thing he says is, don't get arrogant. Money brings arrogance. Money brings a haughty spirit. Listen, every one of us know that. You get 20 bucks in your pocket, you feel better. You get 30 bucks in your pocket, 50 bucks in your pocket, you get a little money put away in your IRA, you feel better that, okay, even if something hits, I'm going to be safer. That's okay, right? You just need to remember what, according to the passage? You need to remember, truly remember, humbly remember, who provided those things, right? Naked I came into the world, naked I left. That's Job. Job was one of the richest men ever. In fact, one of the things that's said about Job is that he uses butter, which was hard to come by. It was expensive. He uses butter and he smears it on his sidewalk. What were they saying? He is just really, really rich. And God takes all of it away in a day And Job is able to say, listen, naked I came into the world, naked I'm going to leave. We need to be recognizing all the time that our money is brought to us by God. And it's really from God. You know, I think one of the things this global pandemic has helped is that money honestly means very little at this time. You know, it doesn't matter if you have money or not, the virus can hit you. So let me ask you, because this is a charge, honestly, where does your peace rest? Where does your peace rest? Are you away resting because you have enough retirement cash? Do you have enough in savings? You have your ability to provide in God? I'm sorry, you have the ability to provide, but or does it rest in who God is? Now, this whole passage is not complicated. We just need to think through it. So think through it with me. But look at the end of verse 17. We need to trust God who richly provides us with everything to what? To enjoy. We don't have to feel guilty that we're rich. We just need to know we're blessed and that God has rightly provided for us these things so we can do what? So we can enjoy them. You should enjoy your riches. God has blessed you to live here in this time. And he's done this so that you can enjoy it. He doesn't tell us about feeling guilty that we can't go to a store packed with food. He told us to enjoy it while we can. Enjoy the blessings that he's given to us. And then he tells us, here's the best way to enjoy your blessings. They are, that's your riches. You, the rich, are to do good. To be rich in good works. To be generous and ready to share. Do good, be rich in good works, be generous and ready to share. Again, I don't need to explain that to you. It's pretty self-explanatory. But I'm going to for a minute or two. Just so we think through these. So we stop long enough to think through. First, do good. Realize that's the only time, you wouldn't know this, that's the only time that that specific word is used here in the Bible. And it means this. Do what is intrinsically good. Do what is noble and excellent. Be kind to people. Do noble, kind, and good things. Be above the fray. Do good, right? We can all look in, if we were to put a little mat or a little whiteboard up here, and I'd say, okay, what's good? He says do good, so let's define good. We could define good. We would come up with a pretty good picture about what good is. He goes, what? Do that. Don't talk about it. Don't just believe it in your heart. Do it. Then he says, but not only do that, but he says what? Be rich in good works. Be rich in doing good. What does rich mean? Well, above and beyond. Don't just do what's required of you as a human being. Don't just do what's required of you as being a good neighbor. Be rich in it. Abounding in good works to others. Don't just look to do your part. Do aboundingly more. I could take us through each one of these things, and maybe I should have. But I want you to be here all day. But there are certain areas, certain people that God told us to do good to. Again, we could name them. You're supposed to do good to your family. Provide for your family. You're supposed to do good works towards widows and orphans, the poor, other believers, and all men. But he doesn't stop there. He says to be what? Be generous. Be generous. Don't be stingy in what you give. Be generous. Now we immediately want to qualify all these things, and so we say, well, we don't want to be foolish. No, you don't want to be foolish. But you want to be generous. You know what generous means? It means generous. Liberal. Bountiful. Give liberally and bountiful to others. And you know why? Because you're rich. You're rich. You say, well, you know, come on. What is generous? Well, let's define generous. Jesus is generous. Jesus gave his all for you. His abounding grace and forgiveness in your life is generous. So be like Jesus. Be generous. Know what he's accomplished for you in your life. It's salvation. Know that he provides you with all things. Know that every single penny that you have was given to you by God. And say, Lord, it's all yours. Be generous with it. And then, I love this last one. And be ready to share. Ready to share. Did you ever tell a kid he's going somewhere that he really, really wants to go to? 2 hours before he's going to go, what's happening? He's got his shoes on, he's got his coat on, he's got his mittens on, he's got his hat on, and he's sitting on a couch, and you're saying, what are you doing? He goes, I'm ready to go. Just all he's waiting for is time to go. Boom, they're in the car. And he says, that's how you need to live your life. Have the cash ready. You have to put it aside at time, or the time to be able to be generous. You got to be ready to go. You know, my wife and I, we differ in this. It's time to go. I say, you ready to go? Yep. 10 minutes later, she's still getting stuff together. I just got to do this and this and this and this, and then I'm ready to go. That's not what this is talking about. He's saying, you be ready to give. I got everything ready. I freed my schedule up for different times in order to be able to help someone. I've got cash in my pocket. I've got cash ready at home in a drawer. We're ready to give. It's interesting. This word is the word koinonia, which is the word for fellowship. My life is ready to share with other people. I don't have to arrange a bunch of stuff. If your schedule, you say, you don't know my schedule. I don't. So change your schedule. Right? That's what he's saying. Be ready to be able to share. So that when God brings people into your life that you hear about, that you see, you're able to do what? Share. You're all ready to go. It's already there, right? You hear of a need, you say, wow, that's weird. Because I hear of the need, that's the money we set aside to give. That's really weird. Let's give it. That's so cool, right? I have time. You know, you hear of a need, you're listening, you hear of a need, you say, man, I have the time ready. I'm going to go. You know, we avoid situations rather than ready to share, don't you? See a homeless person on the street, and walk away. I'm saying you shouldn't. I'm not saying you shouldn't be nervous and wise and being safe. I'm just saying that we avoid situations. We needy people. There are certain needy people. Now, I understand this, that just suck your time, that if the phone rings and it's them, you kind of put that phone call off for a little while. But there's just certain things that we seek, and God says, no, don't do that. Be ready to share. Now, why? Why God gives us blessings all the time when we do what we're supposed to do is just his grace. Because storing up treasure for ourselves is a good foundation for the future, so they may take hold of that which is truly life. So that when you get to heaven, you see those people that you shared with, that you shared the love of Christ with, you shared Jesus, because you're not getting ready for this life. Too often we can't share, we don't have enough time because we're doing stuff for this life. He says, now listen, remember you're doing things for the next life. Understand that you want to lay up treasures in heaven where neither moth or rust corrupt them. You know, Jesus abundantly gave his all for us. He lavished us with his grace. He gave us new life. And we sit here today rich. And material things. We have enough, that's what our little thing says, even as a church, to share with others. And because we believe that, we need to act differently. You need to do. If I were to ask you, are you generous? You'd say, well, you know, I don't want to brag, but I'm generous. Okay. Last 6 months, what did you give? You say, well, I gave a lot in the offering plate. This doesn't count about the offering plate. You do that. That's your duty. This is talking about giving your life, giving your mother money to other people. So I'm going to close two ways, just a list to help us think. The first is this, how can we live like this? I'm going to suggest a few ways. One, include people in your family time. How you can be generous, how you can give to others. Foster. adopt, share your lives. Number two, walk with your eyes open and your ears listening. See needs and seek the Lord to know if you should help. You should be here today with your head up, your eyes open, watching for people that just scurry out the back door, looking at the empty spaces of people that are normally here that are not here, listening to the fact that the Gilmans had such a devastating effect on their family, this COVID thing has done, and saying, listen, I hear those things, and I feel the prompting of the Spirit of God, I need to give. I think number three, be aware of certain times of the year. Because certain times of the year bring needs, right? It got monstrously cold. That brings needs in certain people's lives for heating oil or clothes. Christmas, beginning of school, where some people just are struggling to know how they can or afford to buy supplies for their kids. Number four, be especially aware of those who cannot give back. Pay attention for widows. Pay attention to orphans. Number five, be willing to make mistakes in your giving. If you're a generous person, it means sometimes you're going to give foolishly. You're going to give and you think, oh, I was probably a little too eager to give there. That wasn't the bad. They didn't need money. They needed a kick in the seat of the pants, right? But be willing to make the mistake, to err on the side of generosity, to err on the side of love. Number six, this one's hard. Stay appreciative of the truth that you're able to give. Listen, you start looking for gratitude and worship, honestly, from those whom you give to, you will grow cold and stingy. People sometimes do not act the way that they should. People do not respond the way that we should. You need to, in a weird way, now careful with this, be thankful that the need in that person's life gives you an opportunity to give. Thank you, Lord. I was ready to give, and you gave me this opportunity to give. And then let me close with this. Maybe poke the bear just a little bit. Number one, if you have not given to anyone except in the offering plate, and pick a period of time, 4 months, 3 months, 6 months, you've not given to anyone except in the offering plate, you might need this charge this morning. If you've not heard or been moved by anyone's story in a long time, all you can think about is, well, they made their bed. Listen, if you're not moved by someone's story, you might need this charge. If you have not struggled with how much you have put away and how much need there is in the world, you might need this charge. That's a struggle, isn't it? Lord, I need to put away. I need to put away for my retirement, but there's great needs in this world, and that's a struggle. Welcome to it, right? That's part of this passage. If you've stopped giving because you've been burned, you need this charge. If you have never foolishly given to anyone, you need this charge. And number six, last one. If all your stories about giving are 5 years ago, you might need this charge. Let's pray. Father, we of all people have great joy. We pray, Father, that we would see your gift of salvation, see the gift that you've given us to be in these places that we live and to have all that we have and to go home and to see how much food we have in the refrigerator and the cupboards and just be overwhelmed by how rich we are. And so, Father, I pray that we would have a gut check, that we would check our hearts, that we'd be ready to give generously, that we would seek and look for the needs of people. And we pray, Father, that we would do all those things to glorify your name in recognition of how much we have. In thy name I pray. Amen.